Thank you very much for this kind introduction. Welcome, everyone. I would like to thank the organizers for their kind invitation to be here. And I will try to explain to you in the next minutes the role of introduction of epigenetics, what's this word, the meaning of this word, its role in immunology, and how this can affect also the sensitivity for COVID-19 infection. We'll start but explaining clearly that there are different ways that cells keep biological information. Some is done in the genome, in the DNA sequence, some in the epigenome, the modifications of DNA and histones, some at the level of the RNA expression, transcriptome, some at the level of chemical modifications of RNAs, what we call epitranscriptome, some at the proteome, and some at the chemical modification of proteins that can be called epiproteome. All these together provide information to our cells to develop their normal activity, and all of these are altered in disease. If we think about epigenetics is one of the best markers for cell identity. It's why, one of the reasons why cells are able to perform their functions. DNA in all our cells, from the skin to our gut, is the same at the level of DNA sequence, but it's very different at the level of epigenetics, and this confers this specific tissue identity. These chemical marks that we call epigenetics, there are many, but can be summarized in two. One is DNA methylation. This is the easiest one. Instead of a C in our DNA, we have a methylated C, a methylated cytosine, and this is usually associated with gene silencing. At the same time, we have these proteins, histones, that DNA is wrapped around these proteins, and these proteins, they have these tails that can be modified in a chemical manner. And this is associated also with different levels of gene expression. Chemical modifications of histones can be methylation, acetylation, phosphorylation, and many others. As I said, epigenetics is critical for the cell differentiation, for cell identity. When we have a stem cell, we generate a differentiated tissue, what we are changing is the epigenome of that cell. When we have a differentiated cell, like a keratinocyte, and we generate a stem cell, we're changing in a reverse manner now the epigenetic setting. Even in this weird process that we call transdifferentiation from one cell type to another, this changes the profiles of DNA methylation and histone modifications. One of the best examples of characterization of epigenetic marks in development and differentiation is in hematopoiesis. From this original hematopoietic stem cell, the different branches that appear generating all these terminal cells, all of them are characterized by particular changes in DNA methylation and histone modification. And in fact, in disease like in leukemia, lymphoma, there are mutations in some of the enzymes that modify these marks that are able to abrogate the identity of the cells. They stop differentiation, mutations in TETs, in DNA methyltransferases, etc. These epigenetic marks are also critical for immunotherapy. Some of them are known to be associated with increased sensitivity or with reduced sensitivity to different immunotherapy drugs. And this it happens because all these marks and the enzymes, they participate in all the main immunological pathways involving, for example, normal cells or cancer cells, involving tumor-associated macrophages, CD8 T cells, CD4 T cells, and other cells of our immune system. And we require a balance between all these marks to have a proper activation of an immune cell. Epigenetics is so important for immunology that, in fact, now there are several clinical trials that, in addition of giving an immunotherapy agent, anti-PD-1, anti-PD-L1, they are also given an epigenetic drug, like inhibitors of DNA methylation, like 5-azacitidine, or inhibitors of histone deacetylases, like pembrolizumab and others. So these are drugs that like inhibitors of histone deacetylases. So these drugs are now in development, these clinical trials, together with these immunotherapy agents. Just to give you an example of how epigenetics can relate to immune responses, and you will see later that this relates also to COVID-19, this is a study we did first in cancer. And this study in cancer which showed that in lung cancer, there's a profile of DNA methylation that we have called epimmune, that this profile provides sensitivity to immunotherapy agents, to anti-PD-1 agents in this case. If you have this profile of DNA methylation, this is a tumor that will have a better response to this type of immunotherapy. And this can be combined with other markers like PD-L1 staining, CD8 infiltration, or high mutational load for this particular tumor type. If you go at the molecular details of why tumors respond better to immunotherapy, looking at DNA methylation, you will see that this DNA methylation, in these cases, is targeting genes in these three pathways. It's showing that these tumors that respond very well, these epimmune-positive tumors, they have already a reduced beta-catenin signaling, they have an increased deficient DNA repair, and this can be associated with the production of neoantigens, and they have, and at the same time, they have some degree of activation of the interferon gamma response pathway. And that's the reason in part why they respond so well to anti-PD-1, anti-PD-1 therapy. Even you can have these extraordinary cases in oncology that we call exceptional responders. These are people that have a cancer and respond very well to a drug. This drug can be an immunotherapy drug. How is possible that these people with so much an advanced tumor, they have these wonderful responses? We have identified here using multi-omics, including epigenomics, that these patients, they have a setting, an omic setting, including epigenetics, that make these cells highly responders to this therapy. They are ready to go. They are almost engaged for a clear immune response. And you can read this in the interesting article in Cancer Cell that we did helping the National Cancer Institute in the US. I think I convinced you a little bit that epigenetics is important for identity. This identity is lost in disease, and it's very important for the right activity of our immune system. Not too much, not too little. If this is true, we wonder about if epigenetics had a role and also in determining the severity of COVID-19 infection and disease. And this work was done by a previous bioinformatician in the lab, Manel Castro, and a senior research in the lab, Veronica Davalos. It is clear that COVID-19 is a global pandemic. These are data just from August 23, so it's almost 1 month old. At that time, there were more than 212 million cases, 4.4 million deaths associated with the disease. So this is a global pandemic affecting everyone in the world and has to be dealt in an important manner. However, one of the main issues in the disease is not fully solved and relates about the essential question, why some people, they have a purely asymptomatic or very weak infection, while others develop a very severe disease that require critical care, for example, and even can drive to death. So what is the difference? Well, they have this very good fit, very good response, and the others, they have this severe disease that require oxygen administration, critical care, and as I said, and is really a severe disease. Why is that? How you can differentiate all these different type of people? It is clear that there are some factors that we know. Advanced age, over 60, the disease is going to be worse. If you are a smoker, you have obesity, you have diabetes, hypertension, hyperlipidemia, autoimmune disorders, cardiovascular and pulmonary chronic diseases. All these are risk patients, people that when get infected with the virus, they have a higher chance to develop a critical disease. But what about the others? If you eliminate all this, why some people are okay and the others develop the severe disorder? So we took these people, we took around 400, more than 400 cases of patients infected with COVID-19 that they did not have any of these markers, clinical markers of severity. And we divided it in a discovery cohort and a validation cohort, balanced by numbers and age and other clinical characteristics. And we divided, in this case, there were half of them that were asymptomatic, and half of them, they were severe. And we proceed with the epigenome-wide action study, the EWAS, using a DNA methylation microarray that includes 450K CpG sites. And using this, we identify at the end 44 CPG sites that were different if you were part of these people that had a severe disease. These are sites that predict that you are going to have a worse outcome of the COVID-19 infection. This was in the discovery cohort. We created here the signature, and this was validated at the same level in the validation cohort that was also included 200 cases. These are some examples of these 44 CPG sites. We're showing here those only those that are in genes, in known genes. You see that, that these sites are more or less in all chromosomes. They have one or two sites in each chromosome. We did not see a particular horizon of DNA methylation variants here. But what was interesting is that studying the genes itself, we found that these were members of two families mainly. These patients that have a COVID-19 severity, the genes that were methylated were genes involved in hyperinflammation. So these patients that have severe disorders, they have an excessive response to the viral infection. Our immune system is working too much. It's an overactivation. And genes targeted by that are among several examples, AIM2, that it's involved in the inflammasome, it's a critical component of the inflammasome, and one of the recognition HLLC is an gene that has a differential methylation between severe and asymptomatic cases. In addition to hyperinflammation, those patients that do poorly, they have a profile of DNA methylation affecting genes involved overall, you can imagine, in poor fitness. Among these, one example is PM20D1. This gene, it's a risk factor for Parkinson, for Alzheimer, for obesity, for diabetes type 2. Overall, it's a marker of poor shape. It's a human that is already in poor shape. Even if it's not critical at this level, it's a person that when the virus arrived, had really a poor response to that virus because those cells, those tissues are in poor shape. So our analysis showed that these patients that they have this severe disease, they have an excessive immune response and they have already some background of poor fitness. Here is, you see it in a heat map, the establishment of the signature. Here you have the epi-COVID cases here, that you see that there's a very good correlation with the severity of the disease in these cases. I would like to highlight that the epi-COVID signature that we established is pretty much specific of COVID-19 disease. And we did not see it enriched in other respiratory inflammation diseases like tuberculosis, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, asthma, other allergies. We also did not see enriched the signature in other inflammation or viral diseases like rheumatoid arthritis, sclerosis, lupus, Sjogren's syndrome, infection by hepatitis C or HIV. So our signature was not there. Our signature is pretty specific of the COVID-19 infection. There are many challenges ahead after this resource that we can think about. One is that to think about if all cells are the same in these cases, and this only can be solved by the use of single cell technology that we have in the lab. And these are different examples that we are starting now to analyze the single cell sequencing, single cell chromatin, single cell mutation, single cell protein, these particular cases of COVID-19 to see if we see different patterns at this level of resolution. And it's something that probably provide further clues in the etiology of the disease and the consequence of the disease. I would like to mention that another area very relevant right now is that we're now vaccinating a lot of people, but still we have kids and people that are very young that are not vaccinated. And some of these kids can appear a syndrome that is called multisystem inflammatory syndrome in children, MISC. And this disease that is very different than a severe COVID-19 disease. It has a particular phenotype, symptomatology, fever, myalgia, conjunctivitis, stomatitis, etc. It's very different. We still know very little about why this syndrome appeared. It looks like a Kawasaki syndrome, and still we know very little. It looks again like an excessive reaction to the presence of the virus, and it's something that we are also studying in my lab. I'd like to finish here. I'd like to mention that this work has been done in collaboration with the lab of Dr. Aurora Pujol, with a lot of help from members of both groups. And I would like to thank all the people who organized this meeting.